Once upon a time in Hollywood, Harvey Weinstein was an icon, but no more. His failing was a belief that he was so potent he could have anything or anyone he wanted, and damn the consequences. Weinstein lured young women to be his sexual playthings, knowing such was his influence, they'd be too frightened to call him out. And the plan worked for decades until finally his victims said enough. The movie mogul was publicly exposed. Now he's being made to account for his predatory behaviour in a New York court of law. But Harvey Weinstein's not going down without a fight, and he's worked out the best man for the job of taking on the Me Too movement is a woman.
He has set up a whole life and a company as a front for a rape factory, a human trafficking factory. I think it'd be best for everyone if he just ceased to exist.
Harvey Weinstein, once the world's most celebrated movie mogul.
His name is Harvey Weinstein.
Harvey.
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 Harvey Weinstein.
Harvey Weinstein.
Harvey Weinstein.
And God, Harvey Weinstein.
Now better known as the evil face of Me Too. Crushed by an avalanche of sexual assault allegations, more than 90 women coming forward from within Hollywood and beyond.
Harvey, are you claiming all of these women are making this up?
Don't do that.
Please, I don't want to do something I don't want.
Don't ruin your friendship with me for 5 minutes.
It's like David and Goliath.
They underestimated you.
Yeah, big time. Very much.
Tonight, as we wait for a verdict in his historic rape trial in New York, we turn the spotlight on Harvey's henchmen, the spies that hounded his victims.
You don't care what people think of you?
I'll go away and say he's a dick, and I'll live with that.
And the controversial lawyer in his corner.
It's not unusual for women to lie. Women are attracted to powerful men. Women are attracted to older, powerful men.
This is the court case the women's movement Me Too has been waiting for. Harvey Weinstein finally facing trial for rape. But to the disgust and disbelief of many, it's a woman that's been by his side every step of the way. His lead attorney, Donna Rotunno.
How does it feel to represent arguably the most hated man in the world?
I don't know if it's really fair to say that about Harvey Weinstein, but I know that that's definitely the way that the media has painted him. I was completely prepared for the scrutiny that I would be under when I took this on. I think what I wasn't prepared for was the Twitter attacks, prepared for people screaming at me when I walk into the courthouse, and, you know, prepared for the direct messages I get on Instagram saying, you know, I hope you get raped.
In this great country, you are innocent until proven guilty.
Despite being so widely loathed, the 44-year-old is steadfast in her belief that Harvey Weinstein is not a rapist, and his accusers are just making all of this up.
I think the problem in a case like this up to this point is the fact that the emotion of this case has been taken over and common sense has been left outside.
But it's Rotunno's blunt, some say brutal way of delivering her message about the alleged victims that's particularly enraged so many people.
Women are attracted to powerful men. Women are attracted to older, powerful men. Women don't care what they look like. They don't care how big they are. They're attracted to the lifestyle and the benefit of the lifestyle. Women were throwing themselves at Harvey Weinstein.
The question that so many people come back to in all of this is, why would so many women make all of this up?
Well, I think there's a couple reasons. I think one, there's definitely a financial and a monetary gain that's possible. I also think the motivation is not wanting to be the person who says, I had consensual behavior with Harvey Weinstein. I think that once people started coming out, women who, you know, by any other account, if you look at the evidence, engaged in consensual behavior, now says, I don't want to be that person.
A major reason Weinstein chose Rotunno to represent him is because she's a woman, trying to soften the image of his defense team's cross-examinations at trial.
This type of a case requires the right lawyers. I think a woman standing here could make a difference.
And her record, well, it certainly speaks for itself. She's defended 40 men in sexual assault cases and only ever lost once. The lawyer sympathises with men accused of rape in this day and age, claiming it's become so hard for them to prove consent.
And I mean, people laugh at me all the time when I'm the one that says if I was a man in today's world, I'd make people sign consent forms. And they think I'm kidding, and I'm not.
So what you mean, that's what the world's come to?
Yes.
A young man goes home with a girl and he's got to sign up.
I do. Or ask somebody to, you know, record consent on your phone. I absolutely do. We want to have it both ways. And we also want to live in a world where men take on all the risk and women do as women want to do. And then at the end, we say, well, we have to believe all women. How is that a just, fair system for either side?
But women should be able to take risks without being raped.
Well, of course. But at the same time, to then say, I swipe right on Tinder and then I go home with somebody and not think that they then may try to proposition me.
That almost sounds like you're saying, when you go home, you're asking for it.
No, not at all. That's not at all what I'm saying. What I'm saying is when you go home with someone after swiping right, to act as if you have no idea what that interaction may be or what you may be consenting to seems ridiculous to me.
This is what democracy looks like!
On the one hand, Rotunno claims to be a feminist, but at the same time says women have now actually got too much of a free ride on other fronts, particularly when claiming to have been sexually assaulted, suggesting nowadays they're believed far too easily.
Sexual assault and rape are the only crimes in our statutes where we can walk into a police station and say, I was raped and someone believed me. And that's it. That's all you have to say.
But when you talk about the idea of women facing no ramifications for just coming forward with claims like this, I mean, it's a traumatic experience. And you look at one of the women who took the stand here, the alleged victim, she ended up in tears from your cross-examination. She had a panic attack. I mean, that's hardly a walk in the park.
Well, and it isn't a walk in the park. But again, when we talk about this, even starting with the question, it was a traumatic experience, that means that you're presupposing it actually happened.
No, I'm saying To be able to garner the strength to take the stand and effectively be torn apart and have your life examined
sure. To
a minor detail, that is not a scot-free experience.
No, it is not a scot-free experience. But if you're lying, or if you're bolstering, or if you're relabeling or renaming or changing the narrative about the truth, it's my job to figure that out.
I've never understood why people sell their soul to aid and abet a criminal.
Dear Harvey.
Rose McGowan is the most prominent force behind the Me Too movement.
Today, Lady Justice is staring down a super predator.
At just 22, she shot to fame after landing a leading role in the blockbuster movie Scream. Young and ambitious actress was bound to become Hollywood's next big star. But also Weinstein's next victim. At the 1997 Sundance Film Festival, he coerced Rose to a business meeting at his hotel, where he allegedly raped her.
Give us a sense of the toll that it takes on you, the suffering after an attack like that.
Well, your life is really never the same. You know, you want it to be desperately. When you do get attacked, there's a huge part of you that's like, can we just go back to the hour before this happened where I was me?
Weinstein is obviously, in your mind, the lowest of the low, but all those people that are...
I think they're lower.
Honestly?
I do. I've always thought people that are complicit, whether through silence, or through monetary gain, especially through monetary gain. What is wrong with you? He has set up a whole life and a company as a front for a rape factory, a human trafficking factory. And he had a lot of people there to help him with his big rape fantasy and his rape machine, right? I think it'd be best for everyone if he just ceased to exist, however that happens.
Donna Rotunno is happy to concede Harvey Weinstein, like most of her clients, is a sinner, but insists that doesn't mean he belongs in jail.
You say there's a difference between sins and crimes.
Well, a sin is cheating on your wife. A sin is sleeping with multiple women. A sin is treating people badly at work. But a crime is a crime. And so, you know, is Harvey guilty of committing sins? Sure. That doesn't make you a criminal. And there's a lot of real estate between making bad choices and committing crimes.
But you have no issues representing a sinner?
No, because we don't criminalize morality in this country.
The natural flow on from that is that people would say that you don't care about your morals.
Well, you know, they can say that all they want, but my job is to defend the system of justice under which we all live.
The most common criticism of Rotunno is that she engages in victim blaming, particularly when she recently declared she'd never been sexually assaulted because she'd never put herself in that position before. The Me Too movement's public enemy number one was always Harvey Weinstein, but now Donna Rotunno might not be far behind.
You've also said, I feel that women may rue the day Me Too started when no one asks them out on a date, no one holds a door open for them, or tells them that they look nice.
I was in Las Vegas. Gentleman in the elevator says, you look very nice today. And I said, oh, thank you. And he says, I hope you don't find that offensive. And I said, no, I think it's very nice, thank you. And he said, I don't want to get Me Too'd out of here. And I laughed, thinking you have no idea who you're talking to about this topic. But I thought, this is how men think today. And I think, wow, it's like the pendulum is swinging too far in the other direction. And do I think that it's good that men think about their actions or women think about their responses? Or, of course. But if it goes so far that somebody thinks they can't even give you a compliment, that's when I think it's gone too far.
I saw a headline in New York magazine the other day that said there's a special place in hell for Harvey Weinstein's lawyer. Does it hurt?
Sure. I mean, you're a human being. And I mean, to say that there's a special place in hell for me, especially when you know nothing about the other things that I do in my life. So sure, it hurts, but I know that that's not who I am. And I'm confident with that.
Coming up...
If someone's name is listed in red top priority...
Spies, lies and alibis.
Yeah, that's a cover. That's a way in.
The dark arts of the movement to crush Me Too.
Black Cuba, it's run by some pretty hard bastards.
I wouldn't want to be on the wrong side of them.
And the actress destroyed in the process.
These are people that hurt people. You shaved years off my life.
That's next on 60 Minutes. Seth Freedman has made a living operating in the shadows.
There is an adrenaline rush. There is a kind of sense of mission that I've got.
He's a gun for hire, a spy digging for dirt on behalf of powerful, cashed-up clients. Oligarchs, business barons, but most notably, the notorious Harvey Weinstein.
Not there to think about, is he a nice guy? Is he a good dad? Does he pay his taxes? This was another job. This was a big executive with a problem.
The first rule of being a spy is that no one knows you're a spy. But in the widespread coverage of Weinstein, Seth's cover has been blown. And now he's revealing all to us about this sordid story.
When you're filling out a form and it asks your occupation, what do you put down?
These days I put spy because I might as well admit it.
Do you love your job?
I love it.
Why?
Because one, it's a natural fit for me, and also I think, you know, I don't have any moral issues with it.
In 2016, Seth was approached by the intelligence agency Black Cube and asked to conduct covert operations for Harvey Weinstein. He claims he was initially told Weinstein was investigating corporate rivals, not trying to defend himself against numerous accusations of sexual assault. Seth was given a hit list of 91 targets the Hollywood producer saw as threats, including the likes of actress Rose McGowan.
When someone's name ended up on here, what did that mean?
If someone's name was listed in red, they're like a top priority target. But basically the idea was go through the list and try and find out who is saying negative things because he wants a heads up as to what he thinks is going on. He wants it confirmed.
Black Cube certainly knows how to hunt a target. The firm is run by several former heads of Mossad, Israel's elite spy agency. Seth himself was also previously a member of the Israeli Defense Forces.
It's not beat around the bush, Black Cube. It's run by some pretty hard bastards.
It certainly is. I wouldn't want to be on the wrong side of them, but luckily, well, hopefully I'm not.
It's the dark arts, essentially, isn't it?
It is the dark arts. That are we in agreement on. I mean, like, of course it's the dark arts because that's the nature of spying.
Black Cube agents are suspected of intimidating dozens of Harvey Weinstein's accusers. The operatives, in some cases, befriending the women, even pretending to be from victims' support groups, with the intel then being sent straight back to Weinstein. Seth's tactic was simple. The seasoned spy would assume the role of a newspaper reporter, a job he genuinely once had, and then trick his targets into opening up.
Hello.
Hello. Hi.
Oh, hi, thanks for calling back.
That's the exact approach he took when he called Rose McGowan.
And I was just hoping I could maybe talk to you about a piece that we're doing.
Do you have specific questions?
I said to her, like I said to pretty much everyone, I'm interested in doing a piece on life in Hollywood now, in 2017, whenever, compared to life in Hollywood when people started out, say, 20, 30 years ago.
That's straight-out deception.
In what sense? Like, I mean, what deception is in, do I have an ulterior motive?
Well, you weren't working on a piece.
What if I then, let's say I did publish a piece a month later on life in Hollywood, but I was still passing that information back. Is that still straight out deception?
I mean, you're claiming that you're writing a piece. I mean, it's just fanciful.
Yeah, that's a cover. I wasn't writing a piece, but I said that I was because that's a way in.
And then if you were looking back at your younger self...
Rose, unfortunately, walked right into the trap.
Well, that's because I actually have a signed document from the time of the attack.
She trusted Seth and opened up to him in this 75-minute phone call, including detailing her abuse by Harvey Weinstein, information that Seth then sent straight back to the boss.
Would you describe yourself as a moral person?
What does a moral person mean? I mean, against what benchmark is morality set? As long as I can live with what I do, and I've never had a sleepless night thinking, oh, that's so evil what I do or have done.
But there were alleged victims of sexual assault who, many cases where they say that these double agents came to them, of which you were one of them, and it did muddy the waters for them, and it made them hesitant then to come forward and speak out because they didn't know who they could trust. And like it or not, that silences people.
There's one person who says that. That's Rose McGowan.
Black Cube came after you personally.
Yeah, yeah.
What toll did that take on you?
I think it shaved years off my life. I think them coming after me spun my brain and still does in a way that's fractured a part of me that I don't think will ever fix. But these are people that hurt people, and that's their job. Their job is to hurt other people, so, you know, I hope they're proud at night.
Rose McGowan was targeted by Black Cube because she was seen as a threat.
I feel scared here. I don't feel safe, you know?
Like many of Weinstein's rape accusers, Rose was intimidated into signing a non-disclosure agreement, paid $100,000 to stay silent.
I went to a therapist in New York for trauma issues, and she suggested I get a puppy.
Almost two decades after her attack in the wake of Me Too, Rose finally garnered the strength to share her story. But she quickly learned it wasn't just Weinstein she was taking on.
In your mind, you're at war.
Yes. I have been, ever since I got raped.
But the thing with Harvey Weinstein, he has an army behind him.
He has a real one. But he has an army of spies, lawyers, minions. It's an army of the complicit, of people that they're going to the mat for a serial rapist because he makes movies that win an Oscar? What?
Do you see it just basically as evil?
Yes, it is evil. It's literally a web of evil.
It's like she's got a screw loose. she's not hero and I'm villain, unless you, in a very childlike, someone has to be good and someone has to be bad. I mean, her saying I do the bidding of evil, still I'll probably sleep tonight, I reckon, yeah.
Coming up...
Massage something.
No, I'm shy.
Inside the plot to catch a monster in the act.
I'm feeling very uncomfortable right now.
Please come in now.
And how this brave model...
They underestimated you.
Yeah, big time.
outsmarted a mogul.
It's like David and Goliath.
That's next on 60 Minutes.
I will mentor you, I teach you, whatever, but you have to, you know, relax with me, have fun, enjoy, you know.
You're listening to Harvey Weinstein in full flight. Part of this secretly recorded audio from 2015 has only just been released.
What?
A massage, something.
No, I'm shy.
I know, but a massage, something nice.
Cold, hard evidence of Weinstein pressuring a young woman into his hotel room.
No, you must come here now.
Not today, maybe. No.
A little bit.
Please. No, I don't want to.
All right, we'll see. We'll see.
Threatening her and her career.
If you don't trust me, then we have no reason to do anything and you will lose big opportunities.
Harvey Weinstein paid $1 million to have that audio destroyed, and it's pretty obvious why. It shows just how sleazy and manipulative the movie mogul could be. But that was just a taste of his tactics, as the woman you heard there, Ambra Battilana, found out. Intimidation, attack dogs, media manipulation, they were all part of his arsenal to abuse and silence vulnerable young women. But as you'll see, this victim outsmarted Weinstein. Ambra moved to New York at the age of 22 to further her modelling career, and soon after was headhunted by Harvey Weinstein for a casting at his office. That morning, it quickly became clear that while she was there for work, he was there for pleasure.
He kept saying, "Oh, so nice to see you again, so nice to see you again." And anyway, there was a moment he stared at me and asked me, "Is your breast real?" And I'm like, "What? Yes?"
First it was Weinstein's eyes on Ambra. Quickly, it was his hands.
It was first my breast, and then he put his hand on my leg and tried to kiss me. So yeah, it was very fast. Like, I couldn't even react.
Ambra was horrified and fled the office soon after, breaking down in tears and then going straight to police.
When I spoke to the police guy, I said, "Harvey Weinstein assaulted me." And he answered, "Again?" And I'm like, "What do you mean again? This happened before?"
Police were desperate to land the big fish, so asked Ambra to take a huge risk. They wanted her to wear a wire and meet Weinstein for a drink at a hotel bar the very next night.
I was so distressed, but I really want people to believe me. Like, it was my voice of a 22-year-old model against, you know, that powerful person. It's like David and Goliath.
Yesterday, you touched my breast.
Oh, please, I'm sorry. Just come on. I'm used to that. Come on.
Are you used to that?
Yes, come in. Please come in. On everything. I'm a famous guy.
I'm feeling very uncomfortable right now.
Please come in now. I will never do another thing to you. 5 minutes. Don't ruin your friendship with me for 5 minutes.
It's amazingly brave that you managed to record this, because when you listen to Harvey in that mode, he's scary.
Yeah, it is scary. I mean, you have big, strong men in front of you,
and you know that is aggressively pushing with his words, but for sure at one point is gonna push with his body.
This recording was exactly what police needed. They brought Weinstein in for questioning the following day. But he fought fire with fire, spearheading a salacious smear campaign in the media to intimidate and discredit his victim.
She once filed a sexual assault suit against a 70-year-old, quote, sugar daddy.
It worked. Ambra found herself under siege when she met with the district attorney's sex crimes chief a few days later.
First moment I saw her, I said, great, she's a woman. First question she asked me, were you a prostitute? And I'm like, what, sorry? Did you hear the recordings? And she's like, yeah, I heard that, but could you answer me these questions? Have you ever had a old boyfriend?
It must have felt like that was Harvey Weinstein's own personal lawyer attacking you at that stage.
Yeah, I walked out of that room and I said inside my head, that's not good. That's not gonna be good.
And she was right. Weinstein once again turned to the dark arts, this time paying a friend of the district attorney to dig up dirt on Ambra and feed it back to the DA's office. Not long after that, the investigation was dropped. Eventually, Ambra caved to the constant intimidation and harassment and signed a non-disclosure agreement in return for $1 million. Another victim had been silenced, or so they thought.
Before signing this NDA, they asked me to destroy every single piece of evidence of those recordings.
They underestimated you.
Yeah, big time. Very much.
I need to know a person's
every
touch.
I won't do a thing.
Thankfully, before submitting to their demands, Ambra downloaded a secret copy of the recording and hid it under lock and key for more than 2 years. Now, she's violating that million-dollar gag order to share her story and this rare piece of evidence with us tonight. Her message is clear. She will do whatever it takes to show the world that Harvey Weinstein is a twisted and dangerous man.
When you were finally able to release that audio and show everyone just what Harvey Weinstein was like, how empowering did that feel?
I think that day I smiled for 20 hours straight. And me thinking more than myself of all the other women. I did something that helped others. And that's what I, you know, was most proud of myself for doing.
Coming up.
The road to justice is long.
Waiting for a jury.
For those who are victims.
But this is just the beginning for Weinstein.
This is the age of empowerment of women.
As Rose McGowan vows.
He unleashed the hounds of hell on me.
To keep fighting.
I've got some powerful allies too.
That's next on 60 Minutes.
This trial still has, it seems, a long way to run.
The world is watching and waiting.
Well, he faces five charges, meaning the jury will have to find five separate consensus verdicts.
The jury in the historic trial of Harvey Weinstein has now been deliberating on a verdict for 4 days. His legal team has already declared that if the 67-year-old is sent to jail, his health is so poor that he'll probably die behind bars. But the longer deliberations drag on, the more observers worry that he's going to get off these charges. Even if Harvey Weinstein is found not guilty here, he's still far from a free man. He's already facing separate criminal charges in Los Angeles relating to alleged attacks there, and that'll drag on for months, if not years yet. And then there's the prospect of civil suits, numerous women suing him for hundreds of millions of dollars in damages.
The road to justice is long.
but you're on the way.
But we are moving towards justice for those who are victims.
Gloria Allred is the lawyer representing a number of Harvey Weinstein's alleged victims, including one in this trial in New York.
It's her hope that justice will be done.
It's been a battle even making it this far, with only two of his 90 accusers getting their cases to criminal trials.
What do you think of the prosecution's case so far?
I have good lawyers.
Some incidents happened too long ago, so have passed the statute of limitations. In other instances, prosecutors didn't think the cases were strong enough to go ahead, simply because they were cases of he said, she said. But Gloria believes we are now witnessing a defining moment in legal history, where women are finally being heard.
It's very significant. I have never seen so many criminal prosecutions of rich, famous, powerful figures who are being charged with gender violence, rape, sexual assault, sexual abuse of women.
Why is it? What set off the avalanche?
This is the age of empowerment of women, and they're just not willing to suffer in silence anymore. They want to do something about it.
Rose McGowan continues to inspire the army brought to life by the Me Too movement.
We are free, we are beautiful, we are strong, and you will never take that from us.
The only thing worth fighting for.
And she's adamant that even if Weinstein wins this battle, they'll be making sure he still loses the war.
He will be tied up in courts for a very, very long time. Hopefully as long as he lives.
If the justice system won't hold him to account, you will.
Oh, I'll be there. He unleashed the hounds of hell on me. I've got some powerful allies too.
Hello, I'm Tara Brown. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.